introducing our first keynote speaker. Now, 10 years ago, our keynote speaker could be found around the linux.conf.au venue in Sydney as one of the organisers for LinuxConf AU 2007. And in the years since then, Pia Waugh has developed somewhat of a reputation for completely transforming whatever field it is she chooses to join, be it our open source community here in Australia, or be it open government in the public service. She was first an advisor to Senator Kate Lundy, where she was involved in the government's Gov 2.0 agenda. And when she joined the public service, she helped shape the Australian government's open data agenda, including rebooting data.gov.au, which has improved public access to government data and helping government agencies improve the culture and practices around open data. Her unique position in both government and the open source movement led to her founding the non-profit and community-run GovHack initiative, which is an annual hackathon that encourages the public to develop open source software projects around government data sets. And in the last few years, GovHack has fallen under Linux Australia's auspices. When I ran this biography past Pia in September, I received a very, very simple response by email, which was, when you put it out all like that, I've done quite a bit these last 18 years. I'm sure you can agree that she has, and it's our privilege to have Pia Waugh presenting our first keynote at LinuxConf AU 2017. Please make her welcome. Thanks, Pia.
Thank you. I should also say that when they first asked me and the team emailed me, I was actually shocked. It's such a privilege to come and speak to this conference in any way, whether it's in a mini conf or at the main conf, and to be asked to do a keynote. It was like a shock. I feel like I'd somehow landed. It was quite exciting. And I just want to say I haven't been able to come to a full LCA for a couple of years because I either had a baby or a new job, or I was babysitting at night because I do all kinds of crazy stuff. But to be here all week is a pleasure, and to be able to do a keynote is such a privilege. So I'm probably more nervous than any other speech I've given in recent years. So given the topic of today, or of this week, around the future of open source, I thought, because I never do anything in halves, that I'd start with the future of humans. and as a bit of a topic to explore, because I genuinely believe we're at a bit of a tipping point right now, and a very important tipping point, where we have at our disposal all of the philosophical and technical means to invent whatever world we want, but we're at risk of just reinventing the past with shiny new things. So what I'm going to do is, and for me, the way that I came to this way of thinking actually has fairly early roots. I had my first existential crisis at 4, and have spent every year, every day since then, trying to figure out the meaning of life. And at one point, I wasn't sure, whether it was even possible, and I discovered this whole free and open source software community. And it sort of really helped me realize that we actually can shape our own meaning, not just for ourselves, but for our entire species, our entire global society. And it was quite an empowering thing. So started like a lot of different people did as a sysadmin, and that really set me up for this world because it helped me understand how to see things in terms of systems. Because in any decent sysadmin goes looking for the config file, start tweaking and optimizing and improving things. Well, I just do that, for the whole of society, and it's good fun. So let's jump into it. This talk is about trying to make active choices about the sort of future that we want. Active choices. Passive choices are still a choice. If you're choosing to maintain the status quo, you are actually choosing the status quo. We spend a lot of time doing all kinds of interesting, fun stuff, as we should. If it's not fun, we don't do stuff. But making those active choices to recognize what's symptomatic relief and what's curing the illnesses is an important part of what we do. But I'm going to start at the beginning first, because we're going to go back a little way, just a little way. So I've brought to you some brilliant art, work of my own, largely, apart from in a second. We evolved over hundreds of thousands of years, and over hundreds of thousands of years, the key thing that helped us rapidly evolve was a model of cooperative competitiveness, right? So you had little groups all around the world who, through trade, through travel, would share with each other knowledge, would share new ways of doing things, would observe in each other new ways of doing things. And even though the latency was quite large, we did have collective knowledge over time that actually, you know, always was stepping up, always was improving upon the status quo, always building on the shoulders of giants. So we actually were able as a species to inhabit every, you know, every continent, the most diverse range of environments. We're able to establish culture, language, trade, travel, all these things as a species, you know, over the last 200,000 years. It's really quite remarkable, with very little tools. And we built our tools as we went. But in recent millennia, we started building cities. And this is only, you know, a few thousand years old, really. And we created these highly differentiated and integrated systems, social systems. Why is that important? Well, because when you have to do everything yourself to meet your basic needs, then you don't really have a lot of spare time. But when you can split that load and start sharing those basic requirements to survive across a community of people, and then a very large community of people, suddenly there's more time to specialize, which means that rapid improvements within all individual things. But suddenly there's also, with spare time comes philosophy and perspective and religion and meaning and all those kinds of things. Whosever's that is, please turn it off. So in recent millennia, we basically led to rapid advancements, much more fast advancements, because we got capacity. We had, you know, a lot of people living in cities, and we were able to build these crazy at times political, social, economic environments that in that. And of course, with great cities came sometimes great leaders. You ended up having great surplus, and with great surplus came great power, and with great power came usually great, you know, rulers, but oftentimes not entirely great rulers. And of course, those great powers created great inequalities. And every so often, we decided to burn down those cities to remind them. I didn't draw that one. But it is interesting, isn't it? With great power comes great inequality. With great inequality, every so often, the people would get sick of it and revolt. But we constantly had this cycle. So what would happen would be we were actually doing symptomatic relief then. We'd say, well, this ruler sucks, so let's get rid of them, put another ruler in place, and then that ruler eventually would turn out the same. You know, we've repeated that pattern a lot. I guess in recent centuries, we've seen a different model, and this is where it gets kind of exciting for me. We, in about 250 years ago, started a range of independence movements around the world. And some of those, the roots of those independence movements are, again, millennia old, but it's the speed of those independence movements that's quite interesting. And what those independence movements did was they started to codify the idea of inalienable rights, that an individual had rights. That's a new concept, because up until then I was just a peasant, and my father was a peasant, and my daughter was a peasant, and you know, kings came and went, but we just tried to get by. Suddenly it was like, well, why can't I choose the king if this one sucks? Why can't I be the king? Indeed, if all people are equal, then why does that person get more than me? You know, we started to create and embed a new way of thinking that actually made kings of us all over a number of years. And so that actually paved the way for this massive cultural shift and this massive distribution of power, because power is partly, you know, the wielding of power, but it's partly believing you have power. One of the things I found in, I've worked in the public service, private service, non-profit, you know, all kinds of different places, specifically because I'm trying to understand this crazy system that we call, you know, human society, right? And one of the things I really found going into the public service is the amount of people that say, oh, I'm so disempowered. I'm like, what? But you can do all kinds of stuff. You've got, you know, the technology, we have the technology. You've got the means, you've got contacts, you've got, you know, a roof over your head, you've got so much. Why do you feel disempowered? Oh, because my manager told me I can't go and speak to somebody. I'm like, well, screw your manager. Like, you are powerful. We are. This is so interestingly cool. We are the most powerful individually in the history of our species. And that's only getting more so, right? In the history of our species, individually the most powerful. Collectively, that only expounds. What's that word? Compounds. It's amazing how that distribution of power is starting to create new opportunities. And so that cultural shift actually led to the expectation from individuals that they can play a role in their own future, right? So from my perspective, the internet as a, you know, as a technical solution. Open source as a movement, open knowledge as a movement. All of these things are actually part of the same thing, which is they are both a product of that philosophical shift and an amplifier of that philosophical shift. So all that's happening now is that everything is starting to go up asymptotically, and we're only here, right? If you look at any measure of human livelihood or human benefit or human quality of life, over the last 200,000 years, this is what it sort of looks like. And we're on the cusp of this fantastic opportunity to really skyrocket. But it's not to say there's not still matters of inequality or disability or all kinds of other things that we need to be more active in dealing with progressively. But it's still an interesting point to be. So this idea that anyone has the right to life and liberty started this decentralized of power, which introduced then the need for legitimacy of government, the need for social contract, the need for citizens to actually have a say and have consent in the wielding of power over them. This is, those two things combined of the independence movements plus technology as the amplifier of that has brought us to where we are today, broadly speaking. So I've written it all into a... I thought this. I've done a very simple changelog, you know. I'm going to cover it. So our first version, we fought from Homo erectus. Of course, we weren't entirely confident in the direction of that project and of the leadership of it, but we let them still make some contributions, as it turns out. Quite some time later, we added some new agricultural libraries. That was definitely a new addition and a new version. And that, you know, we think will create some surplus and population explosion. Don't know, but it's heaps less resource intensive, and that's pretty cool. We switched from rural to urban operating environment, but basically still kept the same kind of approach, same sort of power mechanisms, but you still had a single core of power. We introduced the printing press. Really, that was just a more efficient way of getting information out there. We don't think it'll do very much more beyond that. That's just a minor patch. Agricultural libraries replaced by industrial libraries, but still single core, but much faster. We implemented new permissions called rights, and we did some early prototyping of multi-core processing. Started to play with distributed power and communications. You know, we'll see how that goes. And then very recently, of course, we had a whole new comms protocol to distribute the rights, and the printing press was unexpectedly useful, and we've moved from basic multi-core to clusters of independent processors. The history of the humans, ladies and gentlemen, so, okay. Okay, that was fun. So, I spent way too much time on that, actually. Citizens have the power now, that have powers now that have traditionally, or at least when I say traditionally, over a few thousand years, have been dramatically centralized. When we moved into those cities, we needed systems to centralized management and control of resources because we lived in a time of scarcity. We've now moved into a time of surplus, and we can actually do these things in a distributed way a lot more effectively, as we're seeing. It's a very interesting change. So that distribution of stuff has led to distribution of the ability to publish, the ability to communicate, the ability to monitor. It's interesting, isn't it? It's not just the state monitoring the people, it's the people monitoring the state and indeed each other. We have massive distribution of property on its way. You know, 3D printing is still in its early days, but there's so much interesting things that can happen in that technology space. But and the key one is, interestingly, and this terrifies the intel and security agencies, but enforcement. Any individual, you know, especially if they get a couple of mates together with a computer, can disrupt an economy, can disrupt a company, can disrupt another person. I'm not saying that's a good or bad thing. It's just the reality of today, and that reality is of itself interesting and something we need to be more realistic about. So, to this, you know, the point to this rapid and oversimplified historical introduction is kind of threefold. First of all, we're more powerful than we ever have been before. Important to understand and important to grasp that. Secondly, the rate of change is only increasing. That, you know, that chart, we're only going up. And number three, we made all of this up. Hence my Lego. And we can make it up again if we wish. We made up these systems, we made up these powers, we made, you know, this architecture, we made up these governments, we made up all of it, right? It is all a figment of our imagination, and I'm not being all matrixy, but it is something that we made up, which means, importantly, we can make it up again. If it's not fit for purpose, we can get rid of it. We don't have to carry with us the systems, the thinking, or the beliefs of our past to stop us from moving into our future. I think this is the right time, and this is why the tone and theme of this conference this week is such a good time to have this conversation, because if we reinvent the future in the mirror of the past, then how much progress are we really making? So we can choose our own adventure, or we can let others choose it for us, but we have that option now, which we probably didn't have in the past. So the more, and it's interesting, isn't it? The more powerful we are, other people feel more disempowered. Technology has become this thing that people outsource even thinking about it. You know, we say we work in IT or tech or whatever term we want to give ourselves, and people's eyes immediately glaze over. It's interesting, isn't it? But then they still want to know, you know, which laptop to buy or which antivirus software or whatever, and of which we all laugh, of course. But the amount of people that they start from the premise that, I'm sorry, the software can't do that. How many times have you heard, you can't do that, that's not how the system is, but this is how we've always done it, so this is how we should do it. One of the jobs I started in government was particularly funny. I was hired to do a very specific role, and what I did in the first 2 weeks was automate 70% of my job and then said, now I want data gov.au. Now, they kind of knew that was coming, but the point is that a lot of people, when I first got in that first week or two, was like, but we do it this way. I'm like, yeah, but that way is terrible. But this is the way that we do it. And I said, okay, cool. Here's how much time it takes me to do it your way. Here's how much time it takes me to do it my way. Are you going to sign off on the extra hours it's going to take me to do it your way? Oh, I can't do that. Okay, cool. We have an accord. We can reinvent. And the problem is, of course, in a lot of places, and this isn't limited to government, is that people go in shiny-eyed and then think that the way that they're taught is the way it has to be. We've outsourced even thinking critically about the most basic of things. The amount of, and the thing is, it's not that the people aren't creative. Everybody is creative. Every person that I've ever met has something fascinating about them. Now, sometimes you have to dig a little bit to find it, but every person has something fascinating. But the problem is that they switch off that creativity, that co-creation, that maker aspect of their brain when they come to work, right? But they still apply it at home with their kids, or with their families, and their hobbies and playtime. But they switch off when they come to work. You know, we've got some really screwed up ideas about work at the moment. So we're demonstrably masters at change, but life has become so big so fast that change has become scary for a lot of these people. But the change isn't going to slow down, so how do we bring them on the ride a little bit? So I think we're at a bit of a significant tipping point. I think that the world could go one of many ways at this point, but we need to actively make those decisions. So how could the world be better? Let's explore, you know, possible futures for a second, because I think it's sometimes fun to play with hypotheticals as a way of exploring what would stop us getting to those hypotheticals. So the first one is obviously around property. 3D printing is still seen as a bit of a fun thing, you know. Look, we can, you know, make something in 3D for chocolate. Now it's already got a lot more serious recently when people went, oh, I can 3D print an organ donation. What's that going to mean for, you know, the organ register? What's that going to mean for people who have to wait 18 months for a kidney right now? What does that mean? You know, that suddenly started making it real for people. But you can take it so much further. Imagine, you know, getting to some of the sci-fi that we all love, being able to just throw any matter into a nano deconstructor to have new matter reconstructed and then something printed. We could, in our lifetime, actually solve hunger and poverty. Now, this is obviously only dealing with the property aspect of that and the food aspect of that, but that's a fascinating concept. And yet, early conversations about 3D printers were always stuck in, and I got into a whole bunch of these very early on when a whole bunch of free trade agreements were being negotiated, copyright. And it was suddenly like, oh, we have to limit this technology from being too big and too great because of copyright. It's like, why are we protecting business models that are already antiquated and out of date at the cost of humans? What do we care about as people, as a society, as a... And of course, you say this to a person in a suit who's turned off any maker or creative aspect to them, and they're like, so. So, you know, we have these opportunities, and it's amazing. We have the opportunity to tackle scarcity, and that's a fascinating opportunity. So the second one I want to quickly talk about is automation. There's a wonderful book written by a guy called Tim Dunlop, and I'll tweet it after this, about the future of work. And I remember probably 15 years ago, so I was brought up in a very hardworking family. You know, I remember doing Christmas Eve, packing ice, you know, when I was eight. Probably a slightly twisted childhood, but, you know, always working. And I remember when I was about 25, someone saying, but why do you work? I'm like, what? What do you mean, why do I work? Because it's important, and it makes, you know, me a valuable contributor to society. And it's because you just have to work. You can't even question it. But I did question it, of course, because I tried to change systems. And it really made you think. We are so scared right now, collectively, of, well, we're not, because we're nerds, but collectively, people are scared about what technology can do for jobs. And it's the same every generation, right? Whether it's a bloody Model T Ford or AI, everyone's scared about computers taking jobs. And yet we still manage to thrive, right? But why are we obsessed with a 40-hour work week? Why don't we work one day a week and be paid the same amount to do high-value work and automate the rest and actually spend the rest of our time doing, you know, culture, arts, philosophy, and actually improving our lives? Why do we have this obsession with the value of a person is somehow pegged to the amount of money that they earn or the amount of stuff that they have? And, you know, I'm not going to quote Fight Club to you, but it is one of my favorite movies. But we've become a little bit obsessed with value as a very superficial thing. But we have this opportunity with new technology, with robots, with AI and all the rest of it, to actually automate so much stuff. And so using that as an opportunity to question what the future of work looks like, I think will be a very interesting one that will scare a lot of people. But good times. Embrace and extend. It's been really interesting when you look historically about how we do augmentation. Now, we have always done augmentation of some sort. You know, whether it's strapping a couple of feathers to ourselves, or body paint, or piercings, or tattoos, we have always loved to paint ourselves, right? So we've always done some sort of augmentation for fashion, or for mating, or for all kinds of different things, right? But what's interesting to me is that we've got this obsession with the norm at the moment, about, you know, this idea of what it is to be normal, and then if you deviate from that normal, then you've got to do things to make you more normal. Now, I actually think this is actually a fairly recent phenomenon. I think that having pictures about what it is to be normal, you know, shot into our houses via radio, television, and everything else has probably made this worse. But, you know, if someone doesn't meet that exact idea of normal, then they tend to be very strongly encouraged to somehow be more normal. And it's kind of stupid because, first of all, there's no such thing as normal, and the internet has certainly brought that out, hasn't it? You know, a lot of people think that the internet's a terrible thing because, oh, how are you going to get a job with these kids that are growing up and their lives on the internet? I'm like, you know what? This is growing pains, because this is demonstrating that actually we are a very diverse group, and we should be more mature about the fact that it's okay to, you know, screw up and have stuff on the internet. We shouldn't be so judgmental, and we shouldn't be so obsessed with being normal and perfect. Now, I've read a lot of Machiavelli. I'm sure that some people will find that hilarious and some will find that worrying. But he spoke a lot about this as well, you know, this idea that trying to pretend to be perfect only sets you up for failure in the long term. And that's what we've done. Whereas being able to say, well, here are some of my, you know, things I'm not so good at, but here's what I'm good at, means you can start to differentiate what you trust different people to do, right? This obsession with normal is ridiculous. So on the one hand, there is no normal, and we need to just accept that and just stop judging anyone who doesn't fit our perspective of what normal is. Second of all, why limit ourselves to that normal anyway, right? The human brain is so interestingly plastic. If we can actually adapt our brain to new things, if our brain can actually adapt to foreign input, which is what a lot of experimentation right now is starting to look at, why would we limit ourselves to this, you know, really kind of limiting little flesh and bone package? We've always gone and said, okay, how can we extend ourselves in terms of, let's build something faster to ride on, or faster to fly on, or, you know, we've always been so innovative and so creative when it comes to anything outside of our bodies. But with our bodies, it's like, if you lose a leg, then you've got to get a new leg. It's like, why not have seven legs? Why not have wheels? So one of my predictions for you is, I reckon that you can only beat the 100-meter dash by a tiny fraction of a second so many times before it gets boring, and it's already got boring, right? The Olympics have already got boring from my perspective. I don't care how silly that is. I think we're going to enter a stage where we're like, you know what, let's take all holds barred off the Paralympics. Let them go crazy. Let's have fun with that, right? Let's explore what being human can be in today and into the future. Let's start to have that conversation. If you're uncomfortable about the idea of a human having, five arms or no body or, you know, whatever else, why does it make you uncomfortable? You know, having that conversation. I remember, I had a baby last year, and I remember I hated pregnancy. Unfortunately, it was just a really, really awful experience for me. Not to say this for everyone, but for me, it was pretty awful. And I remember having a debate on social media at one point. I didn't do it entirely public for reasons that'll become apparent. But I remember sort of musing upon, why don't we just outsource this? Now, and to be clear, I don't mean surrogacy. Right, because you're still putting that onto some other woman. I mean, why not grow them in a vat? And I mean, the conversation was ridiculous, right? People were like, oh, you're going to grow a sociopath because they don't have the mother's nurturing. So blah 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 blah. It got crazy, but it really, having that conversation was such an insight to the fact that people are so nervous when it comes to changing ourselves. Why not? So anyway, I think that's a big frontier, and I think that's going to be one of the big, big philosophical and ethical challenges that we next face, is moving into this, you know, transhumanism, augmented humanism, whatever. But I think there's some wonderful opportunities. And I just love this quote from William Gibson about cyborg dolphin Jones. He was more than a dolphin, but from another dolphin's point of view, he seemed like something less. We do that all the damn time. Anyone that doesn't meet our idea of normal, they could actually be amazing, but we sort of see them as something a little bit less, which is ridiculous. One of my friends, I remember him calling up, and he said, oh, guess what? I've just found out that my son is going to be, that my son has Asperger's. He's just been diagnosed. I went, oh okay. How do you feel? And he said, I am so proud. He's going to be a sysadmin like his dad. We've got to embrace difference and diversity and change. It's a wonderful thing, and it's what it's brought us so far. And we've got to get rid of this assumption that not being diverse is a good thing. Okay, so other things. Spaceship. You can see I have an affinity with this particular character, right, for many reasons. We can overcome the tyranny of distance in 10 years, right? Because to some degree we have, we're all here in Hobart, but it still takes 20 hours to get around the planet. With rockets, they reckon it's going to take something like 2 hours to get all the way around the planet. And so suddenly, you know, you can actually drop into lunch with your grandma in London and be home for tea. That's going to change things quite substantially. But then, of course, even beyond that, we're going to start moving into other planets. And when we go and set up new civilizations and new worlds, what do we want them to look like? Now, there's a lot of different things I've read for a lot of different reasons, there's a lot of books I could recommend here. But what I would suggest would actually be The Dispossessed. How many people have read that? Yeah, a few. Everyone else, check it out. It's fascinating. And it's the idea that, you know, we've set up a settlement on the moon, and then the moon's got so disconnected from the Earth that they end up creating their own culture. And it ends up being a bit of a commentary on, you know, communism versus capitalism, and that's fine. But the concept is fascinating and very, very interesting. So we have this opportunity to overcome the tyranny of distance. And in Australia, of course, that's quite meaningful given how large a country it is, and similar for some others. And the final one I'll quickly talk about is global citizenship. Right now, a lot of how we are represented internationally is through the lens of a national framework. And yet, how many of you feel 100% that your rights and ideas are being reflected by your governments? Anyone want to put their hand up? Right? I saw an amazing speech, and it was mind-blowing for me. President Sarkozy, how you say it, sorry, from France, gave a speech a few years ago I'll just say it. The first half of the speech was, the internet is amazing, it's done all this amazing stuff for our society and for our development and for our prosperity and for blah, 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 freedoms, blah, 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 blah. First half was all about how amazing it is. Then he said in the middle, so, this is important, as the only legitimate representative of people, of citizens, It is therefore incumbent upon us as governments to regulate the hell out of this thing. He didn't say the hell out of this thing, that was me. But the second half of the speech was all of the ways that they want to tame the Wild West. Fascinating cognitive dissonance boom, right? So there is this, but I challenge the premise. I don't think governments are the only legitimate representative of our rights. I think we are actually pretty good at representing our own damn rights, thank you very much. So I think there's an opportunity to say, why wouldn't we have a globally distributed democracy as our secondary citizenship, our secondary part of who we are, to, and then we can actually represent our own international, transnational, post-national sort of needs in this world. We all, I think, in this community, it is amazing to go anywhere in the world and have a group of people who have similar values, similar goals, similar ideals, similar thinking, similar freedoms. And we all, I think, feel more connected to each other than we do necessarily to possibly the neighbour or possibly, you know, the politician who represents us or possibly, you know, nationalism, I think, is being replaced by a different form of communities. And we are all very, very complex. We have many communities that we all join. And we feel more connected to people in our community than we necessarily do to people in our geography. And that's an interesting change as well. So global citizens, we could flourish in an international capacity. We could create a digital democracy. We could actually start to transcend state boundaries a lot more formally than we currently do. What else? Who knows? I'm scratching the surface. I'm just mucking around here. But think about what that future could be. What are some of those opportunities? The reason is because when you start thinking about some of those things, it starts raising questions for yourself about what are my assumptions, what is my comfort zone. I was born and raised in a small country town in rural Australia, okay, which meant I was brought up with not a whole lot of diversity, with not a whole lot of different thinking. I had parents that were very smart, but not necessarily particularly well educated. But what they gave me that was critical, that is one of the main things that I benefit from, was a sense of curiosity for the different. So when I come across something I don't understand, I am fascinated by it. I want to understand it. Why does this make me uncomfortable? Why do I believe this? It's a wonderful thing, and yet we tend to collectively treat things different with a certain amount of fear. If I don't understand this thing, then what does that mean? So we need to really step out of our comfort zones a little bit. So how can we build a better world? Well, luckily, we have geeks. Okay, I had to throw a Pratchett quote in there at some point, but we are the pioneers of the modern age and into the future. We are the people that are actually building the operating system for all of our fellow humans in the most metaphorical and literal and, sort of sense. So we kind of have a job to ensure that what we do makes the world a better place. We kind of have, I believe, an obligation to actually lead people into a better world. And as creators, I think that we have a good idea about the freedoms we have. As geeks, we will always be able to route around damage, whatever that damage is, whether it's technical or social or political. We can route around it because we have the instincts, we have the tools, we have the perspective, we have the empowerment to actually have the freedom and exercise the freedoms that we expect. But a lot of our fellow citizens don't even realize how not free they are. If you're as free as the tools you use, what does that mean for a person that feels uncomfortable to install new software or to use a computer or to question how the computer works or to question the outcomes of software? We're entering into this interesting stage, and as people getting more and more excited about AI as a way to automate decision making, where's the ethics in that? At what point should a human be making the decision because it's affecting another human? There's some really interesting questions that we're on the front line of, and oftentimes the last resort of those questions being asked. And so, it's really important for us to do that. So, what I thought I'd do is also raise the idea of systemic change. Quite often we start something to solve a problem. We all of us have said or been quoted at many times about, I just want to scratch an itch. The beauty of this community is that we all are scratching itches. But what does your doctor say about scratching an itch? How often do we focus on systemic change, on curing the illness, rather than scratching the itch. Iterative change is important. Scratching an itch oftentimes can help in the short term, but in the long term, what's the systemic change we're looking for? What are there's a lot of initiatives out there to make things better, and we need both, right? You need to be able to have symptomatic relief so you don't, you know, stay up all night with the itch, but also then to be saying, well, how did I get this itch in the first place, right? Diversity is a really good example. We have a lot of programs, and the outreachy work that Karen and Co are doing is incredible way to help deal with that symptom, but it's a symptom. How do we deal with the problem that led us to that point? In fact, let me throw a question out there. How many people out there, right, how many of you would think that you have a fairly diverse friendship group, social group? Okay, probably about half. So that's interesting as well. So, because I've always been curious, why do we not have as much diversity reflected in this community of all communities? We are all about freedom. We're all about, you know, everyone. We're about meritocracy, you know, about being judged on what you do, not who you are, you know, all these kinds of things. And yet there's still unconscious bias in this community. And yet we still, even those who, the 50% that have the highly diverse communities or friendships or social groups, how come that diversity is not being reflected in who we bring in? So either we're not making enough diversity in our friendship groups, or we're not being compelling enough to invite those people to come and join this community. So, you know, either way, there's some stuff that we can do there, right? It's a very interesting question about systemic change. Okay, so a couple of questions that might be useful for us to start thinking about. Who are you building for? Who are you not building for? And who's involved in the building? And I'm just going to bounce through a few questions, but what is the default position in society? Quite often, we get really focused on, you know, oh, that person's just not educated, but at the same time, we're locking up all the education. So, you know, oh, that person just doesn't know this thing. Well, how would they know about it? If the default position in society is very difficult for a person to explore or to be a full participant in their destiny or in society or whatever, then how can we blame them? Like, we need to look at what the default position in society is and make sure that that default position actually leads to a person who is empowered and supportive and able to participate in their own destiny. What does being human mean to you? Does it make you uncomfortable? If not, why not? if so, get over it, I guess. So, how does what you do affect other people? That's an interesting one, because quite often, you know, just build this thing. Well, what's this thing going to do? Oh, it's a red button for a nuke. Good to know. Understanding how what we do affects people and what we value in society. If we only value a person because of their who they are or their monetary accomplishments, you know, what does that mean? I think quite often we get a little bit obsessed with sacrificing our whole, you know, our humanity on the altar of economics, but is that, again, the sort of life that we want? Is that the world that we want? What assumptions and the unconscious bias you have? And don't start from the premise that, oh, no, I'm totally cool, because no one is, right? That hilarious Avenue Q song was totally right, okay? And you all know the one I mean. Understanding your unconscious bias is a matter of, and it's completely scientific. You can just test it. Whenever you feel a little bit edgy, you know, just getting a little bit of self-awareness about what's normal for you, and then when you reach outside of normal, why? Why did I have that reaction? You know, what does that mean about what I think, what I assume? It's important to be able to do that, because then you are able to build better things for other people from a position of less bias actively. And if you know you've got a bias, then, you know, put double blinds in place for yourself. That's okay. You know, you don't have to be a perfect human. You just got to understand that you're not a perfect human and mitigate where necessary. How are you helping non-geeks? Important one. And what future do you want to see? It's very easy to sort of look at how things can be just a little bit better from where we are, but what are those, you know, where do you actually want to go? And I think, hold on, oh yeah. There's an active question right now, more so than ever, particularly with the changing political landscape globally. What should be the rights, the responsibilities, and the roles of citizens, government, corporates, academic, of the different aspects of our society? Because if we don't have any agreement about that, then we're going to continue mingling around in the swamp without actually saying, well, actually, this is the role of government. Actually, this is the role of a citizen. You know, actually having a bit more accord on those things would, I think, be very helpful. So, coming back to, I think we have We've built all this, we can build it again. Are we all convinced of that? A few? Are you feeling it? I think understanding that we're not limited to this, understanding that our fellow humans are only as free as the tools they use, they're only as free as the way that they think, they're only as free as the ideals that they hold, and helping them to actually have the same freedoms that we take for granted and that we expect is a very important thing for us to do. Otherwise, our way of life and our ideals will never become normalized. They'll always just be on the fringe. So we have some fundamental opportunities here. Here are some of the big systems that I think have changed. And I should say, I'm in the process of trying to write a book. It turns out having a baby was a whole lot more work than I expected. Haven't finished it yet, but I'm hoping in the next few months I'll make a lot of progress with it. But just in starting to scratch the surface, here are some of the systems that have fundamentally changed. Now, then you go in looking at policies from government, you look at major decision making, you look at major programs, and you start realizing that the opposite of where we've got to is usually assumed. Closed is assumed, scarcity is assumed, zero-sum games is assumed, winners and losers and nationalism is assumed, normative policies are assumed. So then when you start seeing the world as that, then you can start saying, well, hold on a second, why are you starting from that assumption? Is that the right assumption to have? Let's change the assumption. So that's, I think, a useful and important thing to start trying to do. But because then that starts helping us then do things in the future way without just bringing along the baggage of the past intentionally. My favorite story from my studies with martial arts was actually about two monks walking along, right? And they're walking along, an older and a younger one, and they get to the river, and a person comes and says, "Oh, I'm being chased by robbers. Can you just help me across the river, please?" And the older monk says, "Yep, not a problem," and picks them up and carries them across, because they're hurt. Person gets away, and they're walking along, still in silence, and the younger monk says, "You know, back at the river back there," and the older monk says, "Yeah," and the younger monk says, "I thought we'd taken a vow of silence." He goes, "Ooh, yeah." He goes, "Well, should you have spoken to that person?" And the older monk says, "I put that person down back at the river. Why haven't you?" Anyway, so my final thought, probably explains a lot of how I operate. My final thought, I believe, honestly, that our community, that open source, free software, open culture, free culture, is the best possible example, modern expression of that historical cooperative competitiveness that we've always had, and this philosophical shift towards human rights, powerful citizens, peer-to-peer networks of humans. So I know that we'll continue to win, continue to thrive, and continue to do amazing things, and continue to become the bedrock upon which society is built. But in inventing the future, we just have to be so careful that we don't bring baggage with us, that we don't reinvent that past in the future, that we don't embed the inequalities that the present has been built upon in the future that it's irrelevant in. So I guess I invite you all to remember that it's not enough to have freedom. You've got to use it, and you've got to liberate others. So to paraphrase a great man, build the change you want to see and build it today. Thank you very much, and I hope you all join me in forging the future. Questions?
Thanks, Pia. That was part of things that I cleverly put down underneath this here lectern. We unfortunately don't have time for questions because we really want to make sure you eat morning tea, but Pia will be around for the entirety of this week. Has demonstrated a willingness to speak to whoever comes up to her to speak about things. I'm sure you'll continue to do that through the rest of the week.
I might exhaust you, but yeah.
It's true, but it's also entirely worthwhile.
Thank you.
So as a token of our thanks, we have some lovely Tasmanian cask strength single malt whiskey and a glass from which to drink it.
Thank you so much.
As well as one of these lovely pewter figurines of, this one's a Tasmanian devil.
Oh, thank you. Excellent.
Everybody, please thank Pia Waugh.
Thank you so much.
Mini comps kick off at 10:40. Speakers dinner, buses go from 5:30 to 5:50 at the hotel reception if you have a speakers dinner ticket. Hotel reception for speakers, the downstairs bus is the one that goes to the city. The city is not where the speakers dinner is. So go to the right end of the hotel. I will see all of you here tomorrow morning at 9 a.m. for our second keynote. Thank you all for coming along.
Tomorrow morning.